Hello, you two. It's William. I'm out here spending a day or an afternoon on the lake, and it's kind of relaxing, and I'm going to whittle on a stick a little bit, and just kind of enjoy the day. It's such a beautiful day, mid-70s. But I'm on core land, and so there is quite a few regulations on what we can and can't do. You can't take any material, living material, that's over, I think it's 1.5 inches. But there's plenty of dead stuff around. The problem is it's all oak and hornbeam, which is pretty tough wood to be just whittling on. So I did find this sweet gum here that's dead. It's not green like I had talked about in the previous videos about selecting wood. But we don't have that option here. So I'm gonna try to get a piece of this dead sweet gum and see if we can't whittle on it a bit. So stick with me. Looks pretty solid. So I think we're gonna be able to use that. Silky pocket boy. I like it. It's a good little saw for wood. Don't look very good in bone, but for wood it does pretty good. So as you can see, it just rotted in the ground. So we'll head it back to a stump, see if we can't whittle. Alright, found me an old log that's laying down. I think it's maybe an old pine. But anyway, I'm going to get me a section of this and see if we can't carve a spoon today. Take our time, see what kind of spoon we can come up with. I want to start on the next part of this series is actually carving. So from the carving series, we're going to start with a spoon. And the best way that I know to learn how to carve and to whittle is to actually do it. So I'm going to do it, and as I go along, I'm going to give you some things that's helped me out through the process. Now, as I've said before, and I'll continue to say, I am not a master carver. At best, I'm an average whittler. So, but we're going to see if we can't get a functional spoon. Now, sweet gum is what this is another species of wood that is a good carving wood. I failed to mention that in my wood selection video. I've forgotten all about it, but it is a wood that's very common in my area, and I've used it in quite a few videos of carving. So that's another option for you if you have sweet gum in your area. So anyway, let me get this down to a manageable length, and we'll go from there. Now at this point, this is where batoning comes in, because with the batoning, one thing that you can do is you can control the cut a little bit better or the split a little bit better. So whether you want to use a knife or you want to take your hatchet and do it, that's completely up to you. Since I have my German work hatchet with me, we'll just use it. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to get to read the grain of the wood, and with practice and with experience, you'll start to read it. Now the center of this wood right here, there's the core right there. So I want to stay on this side of it, and also I want to see the angle. So when you're carving, you try to plan ahead as much as possible. So this one's fairly straight, so I should be able to get a natural curve of a spoon out of this if it's straight. Now if this was curved, which would be if you had a great selection of wood and you could select a wood that had the natural curve in it, that would be better. But right now this is what we have to work with. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to try to split this just off center, about there, where I have some wood to work with. And like I said, if you had a knife to do this, that would work just as fine. But I try to use my heavier tools for this whenever I can. My log is a little bit bouncy. Bouncy, bouncy, bouncy. That's all right. There's a knot right there. You see that? Didn't show on the outside. It's right there. So we're going to select the best piece. I think this one's going to give us more thickness and room to work with. So we're going to work it to a manageable size. The weight of tools will help you with your carving. Now, if you had something light, you'd have to use more force than if you just let the weight of the tool take care of a lot of this. The next thing to do is to make sure that you plan what you're carving. Now, it's ideal to keep a spoon or a pencil or a pen or something to write with, or you can use a stick from the fire with some charcoal and kind of trace out what you want to draw. I used to keep a pen in my little bag here. I'm not sure I have one. Nope, I took it out. So, the best thing to do at this point, you can scribe it with your knife. It's going to be hard to show up on the camera, but at least you'll have an idea of what. What I want to do is I want to come back and leave myself some room so that I can hold on to it as I'm doing the bowl. So basically what I want to do is just kind of scribe it a little bit so that I can see the bowl, what I want to do, and then come back and just kind of scribe a handle. Now after time, you'll be able to just kind of vision this in your mind and you won't have to draw it. But for the beginners, then it's best to kind of sketch what you want. Even on the side, if you want to make sure that you have the right curve, then you could just kind of sketch on the side the curve that you want to do on the spoon so that it's curved properly. But right now, we're gonna see if we can't just kind of take some of the excess material off of this. I've got in my mind where my bowl's at. I wish I had a pen so that you could follow me along, but hopefully you get the idea of what to expect. See, that knot is going to be messing with me the whole time. And what I'm doing is I'm keeping the axe straight, but I'm laying the wood over when I want to do a curve. So in other words, I'm moving the wood the way I want the axe to cut, and the axe is staying straight. Kind of come at an angle slightly, so it's less likely to split out on you. Now this is a lot easier with green wood. I do not recommend you trying or starting your carving experiences with dried wood like this, because it is very difficult. It wants to split on you. It's not the easiest thing in the world to work with. Okay. Well, I'm gonna take my crooked knife, or you can use a spoon knife for this. It really doesn't matter. In this case, I'm using one of my crooked knives. and I'm going to try to do a bowl. Now the reason I left this long, like I mentioned before, so I have something to hold on to it on the other side of the bowl. And just start removing material. So I'm gonna get me a chair and get comfortable right quick because my back is telling me I've been standing too long. So basically what we're gonna do is we're going to make our bowl now. And what I want to do is I'm taking this and I'm cutting across grain and just taking it slow, using this hand here to kind of guide it along. Remember, the closer your hand is to where you're cutting, the better control you have. And just when I feel that the blade is bogging down, I back off and don't take as much or try to cut as much. Just taking it slow and easy at a time. Trying to stay within my marks because I have scratch marks here, but probably can't see them on the camera, but they're there. Now this is not the only way to do a spoon, but this is my way. So it is an option that you can use. Try to use. And see if it works for you. Also, if you're going to be making spoons and things like this that you're going to be using, that's with food and eating utensils, you want to make sure that you have a wood that's not going to be leaving a taste in your food. So just be careful of what wood you select. Pines can be a problem with that. Cedar sometimes can be a problem with that. Any of your resinous woods, I'd stay away from if you're going to use it for eating utensils. Crooked knife just kind of rounds those corners off. Very good tool. Alright, so at this point I want to still leave this on here so I can have something to grab onto. But I'm going to take my little carving knife or my little wielding knife and try to finesse this shape a bit more and get it a little bit prettier. This is just a little carver or whittler that I made the other day. It's 01 tool steel. It's got the heat treat mark still left on the blade. Kind of give it a unique look. And it is a Scandi. And it just depends on how you want to, how pretty you want to make it. But see, one thing that you got to watch is see how around these knots, how the wood grain, it wants to react differently. It's wanting to split. Let me zoom in the camera here a bit. Around these knots is the reason you want wood that doesn't have knots is because the wood around knots is just so difficult to work with. Because you have grains going in so many different directions, trying to carve around it is such a pain. What I find is when you're going with the grain or against the grain like this or the other way, the wood's wanting to split and react in weird ways. So what I do is I come across the grain as much as possible. That way it doesn't split on me. Just like so. See how this one's trying to split out? There's really not much you can do but try to go across the grain like so. And You just have to work those splits out. See how it's trying to split right there and travel up through there? But if I come across the grain, and I can slice that off so it doesn't split up that entire piece there. Hope that makes sense. As you're doing this, you'll see the wood and it'll start doing that. Yeah, I remember William talking about that. So it'll trigger a memory of this here. Maybe it'll help you. Hey, and I like to carve to warm myself like this so I can see the edge of the blade. Now I'm always blocking myself. I have a video on this, why I carve to warm myself, but just real quickly, I like that so I can see how the wood's reacting to the edge, and I can judge my angle of my blade a little bit better. Especially when you're trying to carve and finesse carving. It really helps out at that carving. Now, I'm not going to carve the entire spoon because the video would just be entirely too long. I'll show you what the spoon looks like once I get it carved, but mostly I just want to carve the spoon and give you pointers that I come across along the way of how I deal with challenges as I'm carving. Because it doesn't matter what you come across while you're carving, someone has run across the same issue before and figured out ways to work around that. And I'm just giving you pointers of how I've learned to work around things. And by no means, as I said before, am I an expert or a master carver of any type. The biggest thing that I can say about carving and whittling and things like that is to slow down, to relax, enjoy it. If you see that you're getting tired, then stop. Let your muscles relax a moment. Because it's supposed to be fun. It's not a job. It's not a chore. It's relaxation. It frees your mind up to contemplate other things. I mean, you don't want to take your mind completely off of it because you got a sharp object in your hand. But you want to at least kind of just relax your mind a bit, okay? And I got a fly here that's going to aggravate me. Might have to do a smudge fire. But just relax and enjoy the whole process. Think about what you're doing. Let all those other things in life just kind of settle in the back corner and put that in a file drawer and worry about that some other day. just worry about the spoon. Just worry about what that next cut's going to be and how you're going to finish the spoon and what it's going to look like at the end of the day. Be in the moment. That's why I used to play golf, and I hadn't played golf in years. I used to play golf when I was in the corporate world, and that was about the only thing that I could do that I wasn't thinking about the job, because I could focus on that one thing and nothing else mattered at that moment. And carving and whittling is the same way for me, because I can focus on this and not have to worry about the next order or the materials that I have to order or whether I contacted so-and-so back on a knife or any of that stuff. Right now it's concentrating on this. So it frees your mind. And two, it's just something about a good quality knife, how it slices through the wood, and it just, to me, good quality tools is its own reward. You got another knot right there. It's going to be difficult to get woods without knots in. But as I said before, you go slice across the grain instead of with the grain, like so. Go across it so it doesn't split on you, or it's less likely to split. Like so. When you're trying to do shape cuts like this, I'm trying to narrow this down here, this little throat, and you know that if you keep going, it's going to splinter out. What you do is you just stop your cut. Put a stop cut in there, or however you want to do that. And then come back from the other side and work toward it. Like so. It's just another way of keeping your wood from splintering on you. Like so. See, if I keep going, it's wanting to splinter on me. So I just come back from the other way. Just work it loose. And just like that. I wouldn't worry about the little furry things here, because when you get when you're trying to, or once you get done, then you're going to be smoothing all that out anyway with sandpaper, or scraping it somehow with a cabinet scraper, or even the back of your spine of your knife. It'll smooth it out somewhat as well. One thing, when you're trying to do straight cuts, the grains of the wood will help you see where you're not straight. See how the grain of the wood kind of goes up? So what I want to do is if I want to straighten that out, and I just slice it off. And you see the different color of the wood looks straight now. So if you follow or watch the grains, it will also help you in your carving keep things straight. Yeah, the grains are starting to straighten line up. And that means you're pretty close to the right thickness or the same thickness anyway. One thing you're gonna find that everyone has one eye that's dominant than the other one, or more dominant than the other one. They have a dominant eye. So trying to get everything symmetrical, same on either side, is very difficult. And actually doing it by eye, it's pretty much impossible to do that because you have one eye that's dominant over the other one. So everything's gonna be kinda tilted a little bit. Getting it perfect will take something besides doing it by eye. You would have to make measurements or something to get it to where it's perfectly symmetrical. So if that's your goal of getting something perfectly symmetrical, then you may want to include some type of measuring thing in your kit. Maybe just a short piece of string is enough to kind of measure it and make sure that everything is the same. So I'm not saying that that's the case with everyone, but probably the majority of all of us is one eye dominant. So you're going to need something to help you out with that. When you're doing this, and to keep it from breaking, what you want to do is you want to make sure that the bottom part, this part, is always supported on something solid. At this point, we probably need to go back to the knife. Now, once you get it to where a roughed out to where you're pretty close to what you want. Which, I don't know if I brought any sandpaper or not, but I do have a cabinet scraper. So we'll see what the cabinet scraper will do. See, this is just a Baco cabinet scraper. I got this one at Survival Resources, or Self-Reliance Outfitters, I'm sorry. It comes in square. It's square, and I rounded it and made these little deals here so that I can get in there and scrape out spoons and bowls and things. See, already it's pretty smooth. Got these little curved edges here to round these edges off, spray these edges. Make a good fire tender right there. Now, that's about as well as you're going to get it with the equipment I have with me, and my skill level anyway. Take it and use a sander on it. Well, it's not the prettiest spoon in the world, but I hope you got some tips as I carve this spoon of how to address different problems that you're going to come across as you're carving. A lot of these problems will not be as noticeable if you're using green woods, but as you graduate into dried woods and more dense woods, then a lot of these problems you're going to run into as far as grain structure and how it relates and how the knife reacts to different grains and knots and things like that. But I think the key is to kind of have in the back of your mind how to address different issues, so when you run across them yourself, then you'll have some knowledge of how to address that. There's nothing like actually getting in the backyard and whittling on a stick. I mean, it's just, as I've said in many other videos, it's knowledge is good, but skill is better. I mean, you have all the knowledge in the world, but until you get out there and put a knife to a piece of wood, you really don't know. You really don't own that skill. Just a couple of minutes with 180 grit sandpaper makes all the difference. And you could polish this spoon up as fine as you wanted to, with what grit you wanted to. But then after this, so until the next one, you guys be sure and get in the backyard and do whittle on that stick. And if you do, take plenty of Band-Aids and lots of knives. We'll catch you again soon.